Hi everyone, welcome back. And today we'll see how to conduct experiment number 2. So this experiment is based upon torsional vibrations. So the main aim of this experiment is to determine the undamped natural frequency of a torsional vibration of single rotor system, right? So before getting on to the experimental details, let us discuss what exactly these torsional vibrations, right? So based upon the moment of an object, so the vibrations are broadly classified into 3 categories. So one is longitudinal vibrations, second one is transverse vibrations, and third one is torsional vibrations. What are these longitudinal vibrations? So if you remember in our experiment 1, so we have given a slight displacement to the spring mass system, and the spring mass system vibrates in a longitudinal manner. So that means all the particles of a shaft or a spring and mass system are vibrating parallel to the axis of the shaft, right? So that type of vibration we will call it as longitudinal vibrations. Then what are these transverse vibrations? So if I take one simple example of a cantilever beam, which is elastic in nature, and to this cantilever beam, if I apply an impact load, at the end of the cantilever beam, what happens is this beam starts vibrating in a direction perpendicular to the axis of the beam. So such kind of vibrations we will call it as transverse vibrations. And finally, then comes torsional vibrations. What are these torsional vibrations? Here, the particle oscillate about the reference axis. That means, so here the shaft will alternatively gets twisted and untwisted about the reference axis. Such kind of vibrations we'll call it as torsional vibrations. So torsional vibrations will be very important in the design of shafts. We know that the shafts will be used for transmitting a motion or a power, so they are subjected to torsional moments. So in case of design of a shafts, these torsional vibrations will be very helpful. Right? So the main experiment, the main aim of the experiment is to determine the natural frequency of a single rotor vibration system under torsional vibrations. So that is what we have to do in this experiment. So come on, now we will see, what are all the apparatus we will use in this experiment. Okay, so this is the actual experimental setup for conducting torsional vibrations of a single rotor system. This is the disc of weight, 2.78 kgs, and diameter 225 mm. So this is the disc, and this is the shaft, which is made out of steel and 5 mm in diameter, and this is the chuck, so which is required to hold the shaft rigidly in its position, and we will be using chuck key to vary the length. Here we will be conducting experiment for 4 lengths, one for 40 centimeter, second one for 50 centimeter, third one for 60 and 70 centimeters. We will be repeating the experiment, and we will be finding out the natural frequency for all the cases. Now, in order to vary this length, the chuck key, we can fasten and unfasten this chuck key by using this chuck key, and we will be using the stopwatch in order to note down the time taken for 10 oscillations. Right? So this is the overall setup for a torsional vibration system. Now, we'll see, I'll explain the tabular column that we will be using for this experiment. So we will be carrying out experiments for 4 different lengths of the shaft. So one for 40 centimeters or 0.40 meters, 50 centimeters, 60 centimeters, and 70 centimeters. And we will be noting down the time required for 10 oscillations here. And finally, we will be finding out time required for one oscillation. So from this, we will be calculating experimental natural frequency first. So experimental natural frequency, we know that frequency is nothing but equal to reciprocal of time period. So therefore, from the time period which is obtained here, we will be calculating the experiment natural frequency. That is, F experimental is equal to 1 divided by TP. So we will be getting experimental natural frequency. Again, once we are done with the experimental natural frequency, we will be calculating theoretical natural frequency, which is given by, F theoretical is equal to 1 divided by 2 pi into square root of KT divided by I. So where KT is nothing but torsional stiffness, which is given by GJ divided by I, where G is nothing but modulus of rigidity. Here we will be using a steel shaft. So modulus of rigidity for the steel shaft is 80 GPa, and J is nothing but polar moment of inertia. So which is given by, for a circular cross section, which is pi d to the power of 4 divided by 32, and I is nothing but moment of inertia. right? So once we get KT from here, substitute back into theoretical values and we'll get the theoretical natural frequency. So once experimental natural frequency and theoretical natural frequencies are evaluated, then find out the percentage error between these two, right? Now we'll see how to conduct the experiment. So this is the actual experimental setup for torsional vibration of a single rotor system. So here we will be using the steel shaft of 5 mm diameter. So for our test, and this is the disc of 2.78 kgs and 225 mm in diameter. And this is the check wherein which we can fasten this by using a check key. Now initially, first let us insert the shaft into the space provided in the disc at the center of the disc. Now, so make sure that the distance from this end, that is from the disc end to the chuck end, is 40 centimeters for our first trial. So for our second trial, this will be increased to 50, then 60 and then 70. So for our first trial, let us take this distance from this point to this point as 40 centimeters. So make it as 40 centimeters. Now you clamp this rigidly, shaft in its position by using chuck key. So this is the initial setup which has to be done in order to carry out the test. Okay. Okay, now this is the initial setup for carrying out the test. Now what we will do is, let us mark one reference point here exactly at the center like this by using some chalk or by using some marker. So what we will do is, we will slightly give some angular displacement like this. So once we give angular displacement, so small amount of angular displacement and leave it. So because of this elastic in nature, so it will start vibrating. So now what we will do is, we will note down the time taken for 10 oscillations and we will copy it down in our tabular column. So this is for 40 centimeters length of the shaft. Yes. Now, time taken for 10 oscillations is 3 seconds. So same thing we will replicate in our tabular column. So that is 3 seconds for 10 oscillations, 0.3 seconds so for one oscillation. Now this is for 40 centimeters length of the shaft. So in our trial 2, what we will do is, we will increase the length of the shaft to 50 centimeters now. In our trial 2, the length of the shaft or distance between, so the disc end and the chuck end will be 50 centimeters. So distance from this end to that end, you make it as 50 centimeters. Yes, now it is exactly at 50. So now you clamp it rigidly in its position. So again, repeat the test in a similar manner what we have done for 40 centimeters. Yes. Now again, keep it to the equilibrium position, mark the reference point here exactly at this point. Now give small angular displacement like this and release it, and you note down the time taken for 10 oscillations. I am giving small angular position, angular displacement here, and I am releasing it.
3.5.
Okay, here, so for 10 oscillations we are getting, so time taken for 50 centimeters length of the shaft, we are getting 3.5 seconds. Therefore for one oscillation it is 0.35 seconds for one oscillation. So this is for 50 centimeters. Now let us increase the length of the shaft to 60 centimeters and repeat the test.
The last
Yes, now this is exactly at 60 centimeters and rigidly clamp this in its position. So once you clamp this in its position, again mark the reference point here, reference plane here. Now again, so repeat the test, give small angular displacement to this like this and you release it and you note down the time taken for 10 oscillations. I am releasing now.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10.
So I think we are getting few errors here. So therefore repeat the test for accuracy once again. So I am giving small angular displacement and release.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 3.5.
Okay, again for our length of this we are getting, so I think we are getting the error again. So again you can, to cross verify the result, we can again so conduct the test here. So therefore
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10.
So again here we are getting, so time taken for 10 oscillations we are getting it as 4, therefore for 1 oscillation it is 0.4 seconds. Now, so let us repeat the test for 70 centimeters now, 70 centimeters, okay. Further. So rigidly clamp this exactly at 70 centimeters. Now the distance between the disc end and the check end is 70 centimeters. Now again, so mark the reference point. So now give small angular displacement to this and you release it. Wait. So again. Okay, now you give small angular displacement and you release it and note down the time taken for 10 oscillations. Start.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 4.5.
4.5. So that means, so for 70 centimeters length, we are getting it as, so 4.5 seconds for 10 oscillations and for 1 oscillation, we get 0.45 seconds. So 0.45 seconds. Now the experimental part of this is completed. Now let me show you how to carry out the calculations part. Okay, now we'll see how to do calculations for one of the trials. We have done experiments for 4 trials, that is one for shaft length of 40 centimeters, second for shaft length of 50, 60 and 70. So now we'll see how to do calculations for 40 centimeter shaft length, and in a similar manner, so you can carry out calculations for 50, 60 and 70 centimeter shaft length. Now, so from the experiment, we got time taken for, so 10 oscillations is 3 seconds. And time taken for 1 oscillation is 3 divided by 10, which comes around, so 0.3. So from these values, what we will do is, we will calculate, so experimental natural frequency. So that is, we know that experimental natural frequency is nothing but reciprocal of your time period. So we got time period here as 0.3 seconds. Therefore, so experimental natural frequency, F experimental, so is equal to 1 divided by TP, so which is equal to 1 divided by 0.3. So when I do this 1 divided by 0.3, I'll get, so experimental natural frequency as 3.33 hertz. So this is experimental natural frequency. So now we have calculated experimental natural frequency. Let us see how to find out theoretical natural frequency now. So enter that 3.33 in your first row here, experimental natural frequency. Now here, so let us calculate theoretical natural frequency and we will see how to find out the theoretical natural frequency. So theoretical natural frequency, F theoretical, is given by, so 1 divided by 2 pi into root of KT divided by L. So where KT is nothing but KT is torsional stiffness and L is nothing but length of the shaft. So be careful here. Don't take the overall length of the shaft here. So length of the shaft for the first trial we have used is 40 centimeters. So therefore length of the shaft here is 40 centimeters. Now how to find out this KT value, that is torsional stiffness value. So we have the formula for torsional stiffness, that is KT is equal to torsional stiffness is equal to GJ divided by I. So where G is nothing but modulus of rigidity. So J is nothing but polar moment of inertia. I is nothing but moment of inertia. Now in our experiment, we have used steel shaft. So for a steel shaft, modulus of rigidity is given by 80 GPa. So these values, even we can take it from our data and books, right? So therefore, convert this to Newton per meter square. So that is 80 into 10 to the power of 9. Giga means 10 to the power of 9 pascals. Pascals is nothing but Newton per meter square. So 80 into 10 to the power of 9 Newton per meter square. So this is the value of G. Now for a circular cross section, J equation is polar moment of inertia for circular cross section. J is given by J is equal to pi d to the power of 4 divided by 32. Again, be careful here, d is nothing but diameter of the shaft. So we have given, so it is 5 mm, it is in millimeters. Now convert that millimeters to meters. So this will become, so pi into 5 into 10 to the power of minus 3 whole to the power of 4 divided by 32. If I do this, I'll get the value of polar moment of inertia J as 6.14 into 10 to the power of minus 11 meters to the power of 4. So this is the value of J. Now we got modulus of rigidity G, we got polar moment of inertia J. Now we have to find out moment of inertia. How to find out moment of inertia? So moment of inertia I is equal to M into K square. Be careful. So what is this M here? M is nothing but mass of the disc in kgs. So mass of the disc in kgs is 2.78 kgs. So now what is this K? So this K is nothing but radius of gyration, which is given by R divided by root 2. So what is this R here? So this R is nothing but, so radius of the disc. Be careful. So this is not the radius of the shaft here. This is radius of the disc in meters. Now look here. So diameter of the disc he has given. So 225 mm. Now if I convert that to meters, radius of the disc comes around. So 0.1125 meters divided by root 2. So when I do it, so I'll get the value of K is equal to 0.0795. So this is the value of radius of gyration. Now take this value of radius of gyration and substitute into the value of I. So when I substitute, what is M here? M is nothing but, so mass of the disc. So that is, so 2.78 kg. So into what is K here? K is nothing but radius of gyration. That is 0.0795. whole square. Now if I solve this 2.78 into 0.0795 whole square, we will get I is equal to 0.0176. Now so we got value of G, we got value of J, we got value of I. Now substitute all the values into torsional stiffness. Then KT is equal to G, 80 into 10 to the power of 9 into J. J is 6.14 into 10 to the power of minus 11 divided by I. I is, we got 0.0176. So when I solve this, I'll get the value of KT as 279.09, right? Newton meter per radian. Radians is the unit for your torsional stiffness. So now what we will do, we got the KT value. Now substitute this value of KT into this equation. Then I will be writing here. So therefore F theoretical is equal to 1 divided by 2 pi, 1 divided by 2 pi into root of KT value we got, how much we got? 279.09 divided by L. Be careful about the L. For your first trial, the value of L is 0.40, that is 40 centimeters, 0.40. So when I substitute these values and when I solve this, I'll get the value of F theoretical is equal to, so 4.2 hertz. Now, so this is the value of F theoretical. Now, substitute these values into the table. So F theoretical is equal to 4.2 hertz. And KT. So KT value, how much we got? So KT value is 279.09. So Newton meter per radian. So this is the value of KT. Now we have to calculate percentage error. So how to calculate percentage error? So let us go back to the same formula what we have used in your experiment number one. So that is, F theoretical minus F experimental divided by F theoretical into 100. So substitute these values. Therefore, percentage error is equal to F theoretical is 4.2 minus F experimental is 3.33. So divided by 4.2. So into 100. When I do this, I'll get percentage error as 20.7%. 20.7%. This is the percentage error what we are getting while conducting the experiment. So 20.7%. So this is how we do calculations for your first trial. So the calculations for the remaining trials remains exactly similar, but only difference is, so we will change the length. So the length will be changed to 0.50. So 0.50, that is what we will do in case of your second trial, right? So students, we have done calculations for your first trial. So for your trial number 2, 3 and 4, so you have to do the calculations, right? Okay, thank you.